In this screencast, we'll continue where we left off in our final review, part 3. Now, in this previous screencast, we used a degree of freedom analysis on an overall balance to yield four unknowns. Four unknowns were N1, N2, ZB, and XB. Now, only three equations that we could use were available. Two species balances, one for benzene and one for toluene, and a relationship between the feed and the distillate stream, where the problem stated that 90% of the benzene that entered the column exited in the distillate. So this meant we had one degree of freedom, and we could not solve for the overall balance. So here we're going to do a reboiler balance and do the same type of analysis. So the reboiler is down here. So doing a degree of freedom analysis yields four unknowns. We have the unknown N2, an unknown XB, we have YB, and we have WB. Now we could write two species balances for toluene and for benzene. And we could write two Raoult's law equations since we have vapor-liquid equilibrium coming out of the reboiler. Now recall that Raoult's law states that the partial pressure of a species, so here we have the vapor mole fraction of benzene times the total pressure, which is the partial pressure of benzene, is equal to the mole fraction of the species in the liquid phase, so designate that XB, times the vapor fraction of the species, so P sat of benzene, at a given temperature, in this case the reboiler temperature. So we could write the same thing for the other species, but I'm going to write it in terms of the benzene variables, since we've written the mole fractions as such. So it's just 1 minus YB times the total pressure is 1 minus XB times P sat of toluene at the same temperature. So we need to look up the vapor pressure of toluene and benzene at the 90 degrees that we have at the reboiler. So we would look these up or use the Antoine equation, and we get that P sat of benzene is equal to 1010 millimeters of mercury, and the vapor pressure of toluene at 90 degrees Celsius is approximately 405 millimeters of mercury. So now we can plug in the vapor pressures into that equation. We know the total pressure, which is given to us as 500 millimeters of mercury, and we could solve for YB and XB. So solving these two equations, I get YB is equal to 0.317 and XB is equal to 0.157. Again, I'll carry my numbers through until the end before rounding them up. And so what we've done here is we've solved for two of our unknowns. We have YB and we have XB. So we should be able to write our two species balances and solve for N2 and WB. So let's take a look at that. So remember, we could write two balances. We could use an overall or either of our species balances. Another thing to recognize is if we do an overall balance, we say that the incoming molar flow rate, N2, is going to be equal to 0.4 N2 plus 0.6 N2. So what have we shown? That N2 is equal to N2. So unfortunately, given this information, we don't have two unknowns left and two balances we could write. We actually have four unknowns, where we don't know the flow rate of this stream and we don't know the flow rate of the vapor stream leaving. So we've put them into a relationship of our incoming stream, but we didn't account for these unknowns. So we cannot solve for these variables, and at this point we're stuck. So we do know we solved for some of the outlet conditions from the reboiler. We solved for XB and we have YB. So maybe we could revisit our overall material balance. Recall we had four unknowns and three equations we could use. Well, we have solved for one of the unknowns, XB. So now we have three unknowns and three equations. So our degree of freedom analysis for an overall balance gives us zero. So we could solve for the unknown variables. Let's take a look at an overall balance. We write 100 moles in is equal to 0.5 N1 plus 0.6 N2. So we could either do a benzene or a toluene species balance. So I'll do the benzene. We have 0.6 is the mole fraction of entering benzene. This is going to be equal to ZB, the mole fraction of benzene in the distillate stream, times 0.5 N1, plus XB, the mole fraction in the liquid stream, or also known as the bottom stream, times 0.6 and 2. But we know XB. So we have two equations and three unknowns. We need one more equation. That last crucial piece of information is that 90% of the incoming benzene comes out in the distillate stream. So how do we write that? 90% of the incoming benzene, so that's 0.6 times 100 moles per hour, is going to be equal to the benzene leaving in the top stream. In this case, that's ZB times 0.5 and 1. So now you should see that we have three equations, three unknowns we could solve for N1, N2, and ZB. Now when I do that, I get N1 is equal to 123.6 moles per hour, N2 is equal to 63.7 moles per hour, and ZB is equal to 0.874. And again, that's moles of benzene per mole. So does this make sense? Well, benzene is more volatile than toluene, so we would expect the benzene mole fraction in the top of the column, in the distillate, to be higher than the mole fraction of benzene in the bottom stream. And in this case, the ZB is much higher than our XB. So at least from a common sense perspective, this does make sense. So now we've solved for ZB. We have N2 and we have N1. So the only thing left to solve for is our WB. And we could do that by revisiting our reboiler balances. So on the reboiler, all we need is one balance since we have one unknown. So I'll write a benzene balance. So the mole fraction of benzene times the incoming stream is going to be equal to the mole fraction of benzene times the top stream, in this case 0.4 and 2. Plus the mole fraction of benzene in the bottom stream, which is XB, times 0.6 N2. Now using N2 of 63.7 and our XB and YB values that are reported above, we can solve for WB. And when we do, get an incoming mole fraction of benzene at 0.221. So now we've solved for all our unknowns, and we can now get an idea about the processing conditions for this distillation setup. So hopefully you can see that doing the degree of freedom analysis was important, quickly helped us analyze certain parts of the system to figure out where we could solve for the unknowns. And in approaching this, we may have to go back and forth between systems once we can solve for some of those unknowns.